I think this has got to do with the fact that Japanese Americans, especially at my generation, spend a lot of time assimilating into the mainstream culture. Whereas the older generation, they were, the generation before me, was the one that actually went to Japanese internment camps during World War II. But when I was doing research for this, I found this very interesting. It gave me some rationale into the formation of the greater Japanese empire. And there are some concepts that you should know before watching the movie so that it can increase deeper understanding and appreciation of the film. But before we get started, because I'm Japanese American, my Japanese is a little bit shaky, and I had to recruit the help of my dad. He lived in Knoxville, Tennessee, which is where I'm from, and he wanted to give you all a message. Oops, oh, sorry. Oh, I have to press the button. Sorry, I have to go across.
Hello, member of MHHC. I am Eriko's mother, Stone. After watching the film, I truly admire the relationship the Malaysian community has with the title of Malaya. So, I hope all of you will feel proud to be a Malaysian. Thank you.
The idea was to cast a complexity of rationale, motivations, and agenda. by the first emperor of Japan, Emperor Jingwu, who said, I shall cover the eight directions and make them my abode. It's not very clear where the eight directions are, but presumably it's meant to cover, you know, the corners of Japan. But in the 20th century, this came to be interpreted as imperial rule being divinely ordained, and under it, it would unite the entire world. So it came from being just Japan, and then the military just sort of hijacked it. And later this came to be extended to mean an expansion of Japan within the Eastern Hemisphere. Okay, next. Okay, the third concept is the idea of Bushido, which is the way of the samurai. And Bushido can be best described as a form of Japanese chivalry. The concept of Bushido is a modern term rather than a historical one. Early literature, as far as the year 721 and 797, talks about the notion of the warrior poet. But the word Bushido didn't appear until the Tokugawa period, which can be considered as the last period of the samurai before the modernization period of Japan. The idea of the warrior poet emphasized virtues such as reckless bravery, fierce family pride, devotion of servant to master. It also included the notions of dying a brave and honorable death. This is a very important concept. It's stated that anyone who dies without risking his life in battle was not honorable and was shameful. Next. Eventually, by the time of the Tokugawa period, which was relatively a peaceful period, the role of the samurai. Oh, can you all hear me?
Yes.
You can hear me,
yes?
Okay. All right. The role of the samurai was more of policing and administering the country under the shogunate. Thus, the warlike ideals of Bushido became more of a universal code for everyone and emphasized qualities such as loyalty and self-sacrifice. The virtue of self-sacrifice combined with unquestioning devotion to the emperor became instrumental to the pre-World War II government. Bushido thus became to be used as a propaganda tool by the government and the military, who altered it for their needs. So it became to be used for militarism to present war as purifying and death a duty. Bushido would provide a spiritual shield to let soldiers fight to the end. The spirit of Bushido was then invoked to urge that all depended on the united soul of the nation. And in one particular battle, submarines in the Navy was asked to bloom as flowers of death, which was just another way of saying, okay, go kill yourself. Self-sacrifice. While Bushido does not call for suicide as the sole end, the dire straits of the Japanese military towards the end of the war called for such measures. While many lives were lost in battles, the fact that they fought until death was considered the ultimate honor, and therefore losses were considered victory. Okay, next. Okay, the fourth characteristic of Japanese war propaganda is the melding of Japanese culture with the host country. This kind of boils down to the location of the shooting of the propaganda. Just as Japanese studios shot many films in Manchuria, the same was done in Malaya to invoke feelings of patriotism even while the expatriates were living miles away from the home country. These movies were not meant for the local host country audience, made obvious by the fact that the language used in these movies were Japanese, but they were made for the Japanese stationed abroad. Oftentimes, the ideologies of the two countries were intertwined, as you see in this statement by Tani, which evokes the winds of Japan blowing over Tanah Light. Okay, so in here he says, Hirma, I'm so happy that I was able to become a part of Tanah Light. Never forget that the winds from Japan shall forevermore blow over this land. So that's a very strong, evocative image. Next. So images or symbols play an important part in messaging. For example, the image of cherry blossoms or flowers are invoked in a song played in the movie using the melody of Terang, Bulan. And the words go, as a sister dies, as flowers scatter, heart in a fury, man's tears swear to avenge his sister. For many Japanese, just the mention of the word sakura signifies the beauty and perfection at the height of one's life. However, just like the blossoms, life blooms for just a short while and life is short. It reflects the religious belief that life is transitory, fleeting, but can go out in a burst of beauty and honor. Next. Okay, so hopefully this gives you enough background for you guys to appreciate the movie, because you'll recognize some of the concepts being used as the movie's being played out. Now, this is about the actual man and his life. Okay, so who was the tiger of Malaya? There are several personalities in the past who have been given that name. General Yamashita, Tugu Mahmud Mahini, who is the son of the last Sultan of Patani. But the one that we're talking about is Tani Yutaka. He was born in Terengganu in 1910. He's the son of a family, Japanese family, that owned a grocery store in Hulu, Terengganu. In spite of his Japanese heritage, he liked the local culture, and he liked to wear baju Malay and wear a solo on his head. He spoke Malay with a Terengganu accent, because he's from the West Coast, East Coast. And because of his sympathy and identification with the Malay culture, he was able to get many Malays to join him when he later became an outlaw. Okay, next. Okay, this is his house, which stood until the late 1950s in Hulu, Terengganu, but it was later on demolished to make way for development. And I'm not quite sure why, but it says Chet Nino's house. So I'm just wondering whether the mother was called Chet Nino. I'm not sure about that. But in any case, okay, this is Tana in his teens. Okay, next. In the 1930s, Japan invaded Manchuria, which caused the Chinese population, also living outside China, to revolt against the Japanese. Yutaka's sister Shizuko, she's the one over here, was a victim of the anti-Japanese riots. She was raped and killed in Terengganu by Chinese mobs in 1932, although in the movie they are referred to as communists. Life, as it were, changed for Yutaka when the culprits were freed by the British courts under colonial Malaya. As he felt that his sister did not get proper justice, Yutaka formed an outlaw group in 1933 to exact revenge. At the time of the Japanese invasion of Malaya, his group of bandits numbered about 100 members, most of them being Malays. He and his group of bandits were stationed in southern Thailand, but they terrorized the East Coast. One side note that I just sort of found interesting was that one explanation for the support he got from a certain sector of the Malay population was that at the time there was a movement called Kesatuan Muda Melayu, KMM for short, which means the Young Malay Movement, which was a national group to eradicate British rule from the country in favor of an independent Malaya. KMM's leader, Ibrahim Yapo, was appointed by the Japanese military to become a lieutenant general in the British anti-forces. This force was banned by the British when colonial rule returned after World War II, and its leader was exiled to Sumatra. So, it just so happens that I think at the time that Tani Yutaka was trying to get exact revenge, it's a personal revenge, I think he also found kindred spirits in others who were locals that were trying to start off a nationalist movement. So in a way, you kind of get the melding of two ambitions. Okay, next. In later years, the group worked closely with Fujiwara Kikan, or F-Kikan, which is a Japanese military intelligence operations based in Bangkok. I'm not going to dwell on this, but basically it was kind of interesting because this particular intelligence unit was to sort of instigate nationalistic feelings among various groups, not just the KMM, but they were very instrumental in setting up the Indian National Army. They worked with Sumatrans for Aceh, other Chinese groups as well who had different ambitions from the mainland ambitions, and various sultans in Malaya. Okay. In spite of all his exploits, Yutaka died not in battle, but as a result of malaria in 1942 from being constantly exposed in the jungle. They say that he was buried in Singapore, but there are other accounts that say that he died in Johor first before he was transported to a graveyard for Japanese in Singapore. Okay, I think that's it. Next. Okay, so that is sort of my overview. Now we're going to get into showing the video. It's not going to be narrated by me because I've been told that they don't want to listen to my voice while this dialogue was going on. They wanted to hear the Japanese dialogue in its original form, so instead there'll be subtitles at the bottom.
I know. 歌っていきまして、この節は外国の歌だからね。日本のエリコよ、つまり大和魂の表れなんだ。だから日本人はこの精神を忘れていないんだよ。特に僕たちのような移民はこの精神で常に日本人という誇りを失わずに大いに海外に移民しなきゃいけないんだよ。
Oh! Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
learning.
Yeah. Thank you.
にわかるんだ。わかるときも若い俺で昼間。
Thank you. Thank you. Singapore, ID.
Okay, what was the name?
Yasuda.
Wow.
Were there many other
there was a gentleman just now, I forgot his name again.
Peter High.
Peter High. Yeah, and he was just telling me before the show that there's a whole collection of such movies made for Malaya. And then I mentioned there was a lot made for Manchuria. And so there was a whole slew of them. And so I think all of them sort of just has that same theme. He was also explaining to me that these movies sort of have the same plot development, that it's sort of like these little minor clashes that then culminates into some tragic event, like a death of a sister or what have you. The guy goes on a personal revenge, then gets redeemed by some purifying action, like doing something for the country. So he was telling me that that's a normal plot for Japanese samurai movies, and his propaganda movies actually follow the same plot trajectory. So it's something that is a tried and true formula. And ironically, the director of this particular movie, Koga, went on to create some other movies, but towards the end of the World War II, he got exiled. He got censored by the Japanese government. He got pushed out, and he lives in California. I don't know if he's still alive right now.
What was the reason for exile?
I'm not really sure. He didn't get around to telling me, but he told me that he had actually written a book about propaganda war movies of this era. He was giving me the title, but perhaps this is something that is of interest and we'd like to perhaps maybe explore in the future. Is there anything else? Yeah.
Okay, do you, did the movie win any award in Japan or anywhere else?
Likewise, they were Americans or British.
managed to get quite a lot of Japanese there.
I wanted to see which Malays were playing, which actors. And it turns out that they're all Japanese. But I thought they were pretty good. In fact,
some of them were quite convincing.
They look Malay.
One of them looked like my JTR clients, you know? So I was like, oh my god, he looks totally Malay, but they're all Japanese.
Even the Chinese are Japanese. Chinese character.
Who?
The Chinese character.
Yeah, Chinese.
Yeah.